Hi, my name is Wolfgang Schleifer and I lead a department implementing connected health solutions to complement our medicine and accelerate clinical trials for Novartis. In the life science industry, bringing new medical devices to the market has mainly two dimensions. One dimension is the glass of the medical device, which represents the risk profile. The second dimension is the regulatory pathways you can take to get clearance or our pre-market approval for your medical device. I will provide an overview of the FDA regulations, but other health authorities have very similar regulations. So let me start with the medical device classes. So a class one medical device has the least regulatory controls. They present minimal potential harm to the users. Class one devices are typically simple in design, manufacturer have a history of safe use. And class one devices are subject to some general controls, which are around the registration of the manufacturing and distribution location, which is around the listing device for marketing with the FDA. It's around manufacturing the device in accordance with good manufacturing practice and some labeling and adverse event reporting. So examples for a class one medical device are examination, gloves, or toothbrushes. So when we go to class two medical devices, they have the potential to pose a mild risk to a patient if used incorrectly. So general controls alone are not adequate to assure that the safety and the effectiveness of the device. Due to these risks, special controls must be implemented in addition to the general controls. We will talk about that a little bit later. Then examples of such a class two medical device are infusion pumps or surgical equipments. And then the class three medical devices. They have the most stringent regulatory controls. Those devices are usually support or sustain human lives. So class three devices typically require pre-market approval. Example of such devices are pacemakers or implants. So the other dimension I was talking about are the regulatory pathways. So to get clearance and pre-market approval, you really have to go through certain processes. And these pathways I explained, you can see on the slide. So you have as the first example, you have the 510K pre-market notification. So most class one devices are exempt from 510 pre-market notification. That means that the FDA decides that risks of these devices do not justify such a clearance process. So most of the class two devices have to go through such a process. The main submission of clearance has a target of 90 days. The FDA clearance is based on a substantial equivalence to legally marketed devices. What that means, you have a predicate device on the market already, and you just show that it's substantially equivalent to that. What does that mean? It means actually that you have a similar intended use and you have a similar performance characteristics here. So it doesn't mean that you really built on the same technology here. And then there's the second pathway, which is for devices where you don't have a fitting device or a predicate device on the market. So such this pathway is the de novo pathway, has a target time of 120 days. This de novo pathway is not suitable for high risk, so for class three devices. And it requires, like mentioned, special controls. So these special controls are special labeling requirements, mandatory performance standards, and some post-marketing surveillance. So the novel devices become predicate for future devices for some type with the same intended use then. So and the last pathway which we have is the pre-marketed application. So like mentioned, we have here as well, in this specific case, you have a target time of 180 days from the FDA to approve such a request. You have to demonstrate here safety and effectiveness. It doesn't require or it doesn't use a predicate. The submission very often includes clinical data and very detailed description about design and architecture of the medical device. It has potentially then also some pre-approval inspection performed by the health authorities, and the FDA may even seek for a required advisory panel decision prior to the approval. So this is about the pathways and the medical devices. Now you have as a second as another item, especially for software, the FDA uses actually the same paths, the same three pathways which I mentioned before, but has introduced for software as a medical device another opportunity, which is called the FDA Pre-Cert program. In this case, the FDA works with the companies to assess the quality standards, the security standards, and several other items, and certifies then either the company as a level one or as a level two company. And based on that, you can then produce certain software as a medical device solutions either directly without any additional approval and bring it to the market, or you have to go through the processes as mentioned before. So this is a little bit the overview about the regulatory processes which you have on the medical device side in the life science industry. So thank you very much for your attention, and looking forward to the panel discussion.